Man in Dallas suggesting that he doesn't see a deadline approaching to get a new deal done.
Have to be prepared to be trite. We have to be prepared to play without any given player. And that's just a given. That's not unusual business in the NFL. And we've played without players for suspension. We've played without them for injury. It'll happen again this year. And we may very well play without a player that not coming in on his contract. So if that's the case, we'll just play. And we'll play, and we'll play well. Is there personal feelings involved? Sure there are. But at the end of the day, we've been doing this now 30 years, and having criticism, having contract negotiations, some of the best friends I have in the world are people that I have directly negotiated contracts with and had business that we had to get reconciled. That's just part of living.
Right, and he's basing it on the confidence that somehow it always gets done. But what does this offense look like without Zeke Elliott?
Well, it looks, you know, without Ezekiel Elliott there, you don't have that balance that you once had. You don't have the balance or, you know, the defense having to account for a guy out of the backfield in the screen game, out in the open field catching passes, and simply just handing him the ball off as well. He affects the game in so many different areas that you have to account for, that it's a completely different team when you see him when he's not on the field. And you have to account for that. The Cowboys understand his importance. Jerry Jones knows how important Ezekiel Elliott to this team, and he has to figure out a way to get him on the field. Obviously, you know, given the circumstance, he might be without him for the first couple of weeks or however long that takes. But Jerry Jones knows how important Ezekiel Elliott's production is to that football team and how Dak Prescott needs him as well. So they have that balance so that it opens up down the field, it opens up things for the receivers. Ezekiel Elliott is extremely important to that.
How different is your game plan?
I was just going to say that.
Yes.
I was just going to say game planning. Mm-hmm. So as a defender, when you have a big-time player, during the week, okay, 21. When's 21? 21's on the field. Hey, 21's on the field. Alert, 21's on the field. Alert, this. So when you don't have that, when you don't have that guy, you're just going in like, okay, what do they like to run? They're going to put in somebody that's not as talented or isn't as good, but we're just going to defend what they show us, as opposed to we need to stop that guy. Because if you stop that guy, then it changes the whole game. So when they don't have that, it's hard. Quarterbacks, if you don't have the running game, that's what sets up your play action. That's what sets up your boot. Everything is set off of running the football, even screens. Mm-hmm. You set up the screen, you set up the running plays through pound, 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 pull it. There's your linebacker sucked up inside. There's mm-hmm. your 10-yard window that you're looking for. So, mm-hmm. you know, I think it's going to be difficult for them to create their identity on what they are without having a guy like that, 21.
You know, Le'Veon Bell still apologizing to fantasy owners for what happened last season. So what would you do fantasy-wise? What would you do with Zeke?
I'm glad you mentioned Le'Veon Bell, because we did draw a distinction between this and Zeke from a contract situation. But for fantasy football, Susie, they kind of align, right? The idea being you could use the number one overall pick if you wanted last year on Le'Veon Bell. If you knew you had Zeke for 16 games this year, you might use the number one overall pick. So what it ends up being is now – you can't take Zeke in the first three picks. You've got such great players in Saquon Barkley, Christian McCaffrey, and Alvin Kamara. But if you do take Zeke with a first-round pick, you better be ready to pay the premium on Tony Pollard, one of the names that we just saw on that list. Now, he's got as many career NFL carries as I do. That being said, he's way more talented at football than I am, and he looks like the real deal, that if the Cowboys had turned to him for a few games or one game or maybe more than that, he would be the next person up and you would bring a lot of value to. So if you draft Zeke, make sure that you're willing to pull the trigger on Tony Pollard, right, and probably sooner than others in your draft room would be comfortable.
What was your average yards a carry?
Well, I never fumbled. So I got that going.
There we go. Yeah.
Okay, no
there
turnovers.
We we're going to hit field on some other roster decisions, based on fantasy in a bit. But first, so week 4 of the preseason, we know, kicks off tomorrow night. One of the biggest questions that remains unanswered: who will be the Dolphins' starting quarterback? Journeyman Ryan Fitzpatrick or second-year quarterback Josh Rosen? Neither has truly distinguished himself so far in the preseason. Field, Dolphins quarterbacks, what are you hearing first off about tomorrow night, what we might see?
Well, how about this? There's only one quarterback competition. As you said, it's undetermined, right? So I think that tomorrow night what you're going to see across the league is players that are fighting for essentially spots 46 through 63 on a roster. Mm-hmm. Now the NFL has 10-man practice squads, and some of the guys that are waived this weekend are going to end up winding up on those practice squads.
Before you get into that, though, the Dolphins specifically, like what should we look for tomorrow night, and then kind of where do you think it might go?
I think personally it's going to end up being Ryan Fitzpatrick, who starts for them week one of this regular season. It's a safer plan to go with the veteran first, and if he screws up, you bring in the young kid and Josh Rosen. If you bring in Josh Rosen and right away he struggles, which may very well happen with a poor offensive line, some question marks in terms of skill position players, then all of a sudden people say, was this a lost cause, a wasted draft pick shipped to Arizona? I think it ends up with Ryan Fitzpatrick tomorrow night. It wouldn't surprise me to see very little of either of them on the field. Again, as I was saying to Rob during a break, you basically put starters in bubble wrap tomorrow night, or bubble wrap and ball caps, and let them watch the game from sidelines. Yeah.
But, and they open against four tough teams, teams that were in the playoffs last year. So roll out the veteran and
patience, Dolphins fans.
All right, so where you are going,
the deadline
is coming Saturday, 4 p.m. Eastern. It's got to be down to 53. Yes. What does it look like behind the scenes now? What's happening?
90 players are allowed to be in a roster right now. As of Saturday at 4 p.m. Eastern time, 53. So every team is making 37 transactions, close to 2,000 movements on Saturday. Now, it must happen by 4 p.m. Eastern time. We'll find out about all of them later on that evening. Guys who were cut that have less than four accrued seasons are subject to waivers. So you get waived, and that means the next day, another team could claim you off of a waiver, off waivers, and the priority for waivers mirrors the original NFL draft order. So the Cardinals, they'll be busy. Teams at the top of the draft. Last thing to note there is that the NFL has that short-term IR now where players can return from IR. Mm. But if they're placed on IR before Saturday at 4 p.m., they are not eligible to return later on this season. Example would be Hakeem Butler for the Cardinals, already on IR. He's out, even if the injury might be healthy before the season is over.
When the Grim Reaper is floating around the facility,
no one wants
what's
to do
it that. Like?
It's quite nerve-wracking because everyone knows who he is, right? Everyone knows who the Grim Reaper is, and he's kind of lingering right by where you walk in, right into the facility, and he's kind of meandering around, and you don't want to be the guy that he taps on the shoulder to bring up to that office, and he's asking you for your playbook. So, that day's always nerve-wracking for me. No matter what position I was in, I always felt like I wasn't exempt. But everyone knows who that Grim Reaper is, and they try to curl around him as much as they can.
It's never going to work.
He knows where your locker is.
Your imagination plays tricks in your mind, and every time you see the Grim Reaper, you're like, man, that guy's scary.
And even
scary.
Like week six, you're like, do I talk to him? What do I do?
No. What do you need? Oh, no, okay. You don't need anything from me? Good.
It's such a big, this week, dreams are realized, and then they're also, crushed,
which is
tough. And then teams make big plans, and your quarterback retires or somebody gets hurt and everything changes. So for that, teams need to be really